Okay, now we start from what we know about the propagation time and power dissipation to make some considerations regarding technology scaling. Let's recollect the most important aspect and so that we can, let's say, do our consideration and looking at and we can look at the formulas. So the propagation delay, which is typically equal for the high to low transition and the low to high transition, can be written some in this way: C VDD over 2 times I on. So this is the time required between the instant at which the input voltage reaches VDD half to the time in which the output voltage reaches VDD half for both transitions if the inverter is balanced. And the inverter is balanced basically if the ion, if the current when the N MOSFET is on is equal to the current when the P MOSFET is on. Probably remember, in order to have a balanced inverter, we need to have that the threshold voltage of the PMOS is equal to the threshold voltage of the NMOS, except for the sine, and the constant of the transistor NMOS is equal to the constant of the PMOS. And since mobility is different, we need to have different width for the PMOS and for the NMOS. But we already discussed this aspect. Now, this ion is equal to the current that we have when VGS is equal to VDD, and therefore for the NMOS is this KN times VGS, sorry, not VGS, VGS is equal to VDD, so we can directly write VDD here, minus VTN squared. This is also... there is also this term, this Kn is equal to W over L. W is the width of the transistor, L is the length of the NMOS transistor. Let me add the suffix N. Then the mobility of the electrons and the oxide capacitance per unit area. This C ox is equal to epsilon ox over T ox. Okay, this is something we have already written. Now I would like to stress a bit this aspect because it is something that will we will have to consider again. You know, we have a two power here, so we have that the current is proportional to the overdrive to the power of 2. You probably remember where this 2 comes from. Even if you do not remember, I will try to say it in a pretty easy way. So where does the power of 2 comes from? So there are two factors that matter. The first is that the total charge under the channel is proportional to the capacitance of the gate times the overdrive. This is Tn. So this is basically the expression that is valid for a normal capacitance. The only difference here is that instead of having VGS, which is equal to VDD, here we have VDD minus VTN, because we need at least to apply a voltage equal to VTN in order to have charge. Then we start to charge the capacitance from there. So the charge under the gate in the channel is proportional to the overdrive, to the power of one. So this is one, this is one of the origins of VDD minus VTN in the expression for the current. And then we have another thing, that the velocity of carriers, of electrons, in the case of N MOSFETs, is proportional to, let me write it simply, is equal to the mobility for the definition of mobility times VDD minus VTN over L, because this is the electric field in the channel. You know that by definition mobility is the ratio of the drift velocity to the electric field. So the velocity is equal to mobility times the electric field. This is the really the definition of mobility. Why this is the electric field? Because if you think about a N MOSFET in saturation, you have something like this. This is the source, this is the drain, you have, this is the gate, so you have a gate oxide here, and below the gate you have the channel, and you have you have a channel which is much more populated near the source and less populated as we move towards the drain. And at some point we have basically a sort of pinch off of the channel. So you typically see an illustration like this. You have a triangular shape channel, lots of charge here close to the source, and then as we move towards the drain you have less and less charge. Here in this point you have a pinch off. Basically the channel almost disappears. To the first order it disappeared. It disappears. And you need to have this situation in order to have the saturation of the current. And this is the situation in which we want to work. The voltage between this point, let's call it X, at which you have the pinch off of the channel, and the source, is VGS minus VTN, which is in this case exactly VDD minus VTN. And this is the other, so the length, this is almost L, because L is this distance, but this X is very close to the drain. So the voltage is VDD minus VTN. The distance between the point X and the source is almost L, and therefore this ratio is the electric field in the channel. Now, the easy part is that the current is proportional to the product of the charge that you have under the gate in the channel and the velocity. And therefore you have this proportionality to VDD minus VTN square. Okay? Just a brief, let's say, rehearse of where does the power of two comes from. Okay? Why I'm stressing this aspect? Because this is typically true for long transistors, where L is long. Since we are discussing scaling today, we will also discuss transistors for which L is very short, is let's say 10th of micrometers. And for those channel lengths, this expression does not work anymore. We need to correct it. What's happening precisely? If we plot the velocity in the channel as a function, as a function of the electric field, this is velocity, we see something that is not linear in detail. For low values of the electric field, we have a constant slope. And this is the region in which V is equal to mu times E. And the slope of the curve is, by definition, the mobility. So the mobility is the proportionality constant between the velocity and the electric field. And this is the formula that, for example, in the course on electronics used for writing the drift diffusion terms. The drift, in particular, this is the drift velocity. What happens is that if the electric field increases, at some point, velocity does not increase anymore. So if you continue, you have something like this, a saturation. And this velocity is called saturation velocity. Typically, the symbol is Vsat. This is the saturation velocity. So, when we have small electric field, we typically assume that we are in the linear region. Velocity is proportional to the field. And this is true for long devices, because if L is long, the field is small, and therefore we have the velocity proportional to the field. But if we reduce the length of the channel, then we are in a so-called high field region. And in this case, in the high field region, velocity is not proportional to the channel, to the field, but is just constant. Okay, which means that for simplicity, we make one of the two simplest assumptions. Either we are in the linear region, velocity proportional to the field, or we are in the high field region, velocity constant, just to make things simple. Okay, in this region, in the case of saturation velocity, what changes in the expression? Basically, what you have is that you still have Q proportional to the overdrive, but the velocity is not proportional to the overdrive anymore, but is just constant, is equal to the saturation velocity, and therefore the current is proportional to the overdrive to the power of 1 instead of 2. This is the main change that you have in the condition of high electric field, which means very small devices. Okay? So we have Q proportional to C times VDD minus VTN. V is equal to Vsat, and therefore I, the current, is proportional to Q V, and therefore is only proportional to the overdrive to the first power. And if we want to write the complete expression, we need to write something like I is equal to we have something like W epsilon ox over t ox times Vsat times VDD. I need some more space. Times the overdrive. Let me write in a more compact way here, so that I can use all the space. So we have I on is equal to W epsilon aux over T aux times the saturation velocity times the overdrive VDD minus VTN. So you see there are some differences with respect to the ion. The first difference is the one that I have stressed before, the power of the overdrive term. And the second difference is that in the case of long devices, the current is inversely proportional to the length of the channel. In the short devices, the current is independent of the length of the channel. This is also something that will be useful to remember. Okay, let's summarize these points. So we have long devices. Tau P is equal to C VDD over 2 ion. Ion is equal to Kn, which is W over L times mu times epsilon aux over T aux times the overdrive squared. Okay? Now we should remember that this C is equal to W times L, which is the area, is proportional to W times L, which is the area of the gate, times the capacitance per unit area, which is Eox over Tox. So if we consider this, there are lots of simplifications to make, but let's look at the most important one. W and W goes away, epsilon aux and epsilon aux goes away, Tox and Tox go away, and therefore we have L squared, this is also very important, over 2 mu, and then we have VDD over the overdrive squared. For short devices, when we have velocity saturation, we have something different. Again, we have to write CVDD over 2 ion, but in the ion we have W epsilon aux over T aux. Oh, sorry, actually we have also a 2 here, and this goes away, yeah? Right. In the K, there is also a 2 at the denominator, which goes away with this 2. So, times, here we have, the constant term are not important, the functional dependencies are more important, actually. But then we have the overdrive to the first power here. And you see what happens, basically, there are a few simplifications to make. We only have L to the power of 1 at the numerator. We have Vsat at the denominator, because of course the current was proportional to Vsat. And then we have VDD over VTN, VDD minus VTN to the power of 1. And we also have a 2. So if we want to have small propagation delays, we need to have small L, of course, and high mobility or high Vsat, high saturation velocity. Regarding the impact of VDD, there is a difference, because for long devices, you see, if we increase VDD, the denominator increases faster than the numerator, because we have a power of 2 at the denominator. In the case of TP, if we, for the moment, can discard the threshold voltage, basically VTD does not have an effect on TP, has a small effect on TP, because we have the power of 1 at the numerator and the power of 1 again at the denominator. Okay. This is what I wanted to stress. At this point, we also need to add here, for convenience, the fact that we already computed the power as dynamic power plus static power. The dynamic power was the sum of C VDD. We call it C tot, the total capacitance of all the gates, basically, times VDD square times F clock times the activity factor. This is the PD, which is the most important part. And then we have also the static power, which is the sum over all transistors of the off current times VDD. And in normal situations, PD is much larger than PS. Okay, now if we keep in mind these expressions, we can discuss about scaling. So we need to consider what happened with semiconductor technology in the last, let's say, more than 30 years. The MOSFET as a device was, let's say, produced in industrial conditions, so on a relatively large scale, already in the 60s. But at a time, let's say, bipolar circuits, bipolar transistor were much more performing, and therefore, circuits based on bipolar logic were preferred until the 70s, more or less. The so-called TTL family. I know that you have it in the, you have seen it in the class on electronics. Then, at the end of the 60s, the MOSFET devices started to be used, but it was a different architecture for what we use now. It was an architecture that was called NMOS. It was called NMOS because only used N-channel MOSFETs. The real start of large-scale production with CMOS technology started at the beginning of the 80s. I would say that the real boom was in 83. So CMOS become dominant. In 83. And what was the reason? Basically, the reason was the fact that the power dissipation of CMOS was much smaller than the power dissipation of the NMOS circuits. And the reason is the one that we have seen when we have discussed the inverter. When the inverter is in high output state or in low output states, basically there is no power consumption, no current flowing. And therefore, in that state, since that state is very common, the power consumption of the whole chip can be very limited. So this was the reason for the introduction in 83. What happened from 83 up to now is that year by year, the size of transistors decreased, and therefore circuit could go faster. Why is that? If you look at this expression, it is pretty clear. If you reduce L, you can reduce the propagation delay, and therefore you can increase the clock frequency. Okay? The problem is that when you increase the clock frequency, you increase a lot the power consumption. Okay? Now, this is a very qualitative discussion and very simple to make, but of course now we have the complete formulas and we can go deeper and try to analyze what is the way of doing scaling in order to generically improve performance while not increasing power consumption too much. Okay. This was a significant problem of the whole semiconductor industry. Now we can have some perspective, and let's look at the main issues. So we have to scale two things. We have to scale the dimensions of the transistors, and we have to scale the voltages. Okay, let's look at both. Scaling. We use an approach which is called generalized scaling, according to which we follow two different scaling factors for the geometry and for the voltages. We have a scaling factor for geometry that we call S. Okay. Let's assume that S is larger than 1. So basically S equal to 2 means that I cut in half all geometrical factors. Okay. So S equal to 2 means we are reducing in half the width and the length of the transistors. And then we have another scaling factor for voltages. Let's call it lambda. Okay. Also, by definition, if we reduce the voltage, lambda is larger than 1. So lambda is the ratio of the old voltage to the new voltage. Okay. Now, let's see what happens. This is called generalized because we use two different scaling constants. In a particular case, we can have S equal to lambda. Okay. So, we can build a table. So W, L, and TOX are the geometrical factor. If the scaling factor is S, this quantity are 1 over S of the old quantity. Okay, S, for example, S equal to 2, we're cutting in half the width, the length of the channel, and the thickness of the oxide. Then the supply voltage and the threshold voltage scale by 1 over lambda for the same reason. Now let's look at the propagation delay. Okay? In the non-saturation velocity regime. Okay, we can have a look at the previous expression here. So let's look at this situation. Tp, tau p is proportional to L squared. So if L squares as 1 over s, tau p squares and 1 over s to the power of 2. Okay. Also, you have a scaling of the voltages. VDD and VTN scale by a factor which is 1 over lambda. You see, at the numerator you have first power, at the denominator you have second power. Totally, this fraction scales as lambda. So tau p scales as lambda over s squared. Okay? We can write it here. Lambda over s squared. Again, just in order to make an example, if we scale the the geometry by a factor of 2 and the voltage by a factor of 2, we have a scaling of tau p by a factor of 2 again. So we cut in half the propagation delay, and this means that we can use a clock frequency that is twice as fast. Okay, since with the scaling we go to very small devices, we also have to look at the propagation delay in the case of velocity saturation. In this case, things are a little bit different. Let's look at the expression here. You can see that now tau p is proportional to L, so we have 1 over s to the power of 1, and then is independent of the scaling factor of V, because both the numerator and the denominator scale in the same way. So we have just tau p proportional to 1 over s. Since this situation is the most relevant one, we can use this situation for making an estimation of the clock frequency, let's say the maximum clock frequency that we can use. What is the maximum clock frequency? If tau p scales as 1 over s, it means that we can scale of the same factor the clock period, and therefore the frequency scales like s. Okay, we have almost considered everything. There are a couple of things we need to consider here. I can cheat. Use some more space here. There are a few factors still. The C, the capacitance. The capacitance is important for the computation of the dynamic power. So capacitance is proportional to W times L over T aux. So it's easy to see that it is proportional to 1 over S, because all the three factors scale as 1 over s, therefore the product of W and L over T aux scales as 1 over s. Then we have the dynamic power. And the dynamic power is, we can have a look at this expression, is C dot, which scales as 1 over s, times F clock, if we consider the maximum frequency, this scales with S. So S and 1 over S make 1 when you multiply them. And then we have the scaling of VDD, which is 1 over lambda. So power scales as 1 over lambda squared. All the factors scale, but some you have some cancellations. So 1 over S times 1 over lambda squared times S make 1 over lambda squared. So okay, and finally we have the area. The area is proportional to W times L, so of course it scales as 1 over S squared. Okay, last considerations, the power density. Power density is PD over A. So the power per unit area. The power per unit area is S squared over lambda squared. Why the power per unit area is important? Because when you do this scaling, typically you do not reduce the size of the chip. You keep the same size of the chip, but you put more transistor in them. Okay, so at the end, the area is more or less constant, and therefore, even if you have a reduction of the total power dissipated by a circuit, you have many more circuits. So you have to make the ratio of the total power dissipation to the area. Okay. This is, since the area at the end is more or less constant in chips, you only put much more stuff in them, the total power dissipation of the chip is proportional to the power density. You can see there are these two factors. So now we can make some considerations and also connect them to what happened historically. Let me write here because it's more convenient for me since I have these expressions here. There are two typical situations. One typical situation is the constant voltage scaling. This is equal to saying lambda is equal to 1 and you only scale S. What's the advantage of this situation? The advantage is that you can keep the voltage constant, the supply voltage constant, and therefore if you have already designed the system, for example, for working at 5 volts, you can add additional integrated circuits and they still can work with the 5 volt of supply voltage. So it is very convenient. For example, for CMOS, the initial supply voltage was 5 volt, and this was convenient because it was the same supply voltage that was used for TTL, the bipolar logic. So one could keep the same supply voltage and basically make a substitution chip by chip of the circuit. And of course, this was very convenient and was kept for this reason up to 1992. So up to 1992, CMOS had a supply voltage of 5 volt. So VDD, so historically this was used, was 5 volt up to 1992. So it was not an abrupt change. Basically in 1991, 1992, some circuits arrived to the market with a different supply voltage, a smaller one. For some time they coexisted, and then only the lower supply voltage ones, let's say, continue to be on the market. So what happens when you have constant voltage scaling? The nice part is that you can increase the clock frequency without any problem. You continue to have the same power consumption because lambda is equal to 1, so PD is constant, but the real problem is that the area is smaller, so the power density becomes the power over the area becomes proportional to 1 over S squared. So when you scale down, it goes up. Since you still keep the area constant and you put much more stuff in it, you have chips that start to consume more and more. They become extremely hot and it becomes very difficult to cool them. Okay, so this problem was called power crunch. At the beginning, it was not a problem because the total power dissipation was small, but then circuits started to go faster and faster, and therefore, at some point, this constant voltage scaling could not be followed anymore. So, second possibility, it's called constant field scaling. In the case of constant field scaling, you put lambda equal to S. So you scale at the same time the volt with the same factor, the voltage and the length. And this means that all the electric field that are proportional to the voltages over the length are more or less constant. This is the reason why it is called constant field scaling. Okay? This is also good for several reasons. We will see the main reason here when we look at the power density. You see, if you have S, if you go down and you see S equal to lambda, you see that the power density becomes constant. So PD equal to 1, A over A is equal to 1. So it's a constant power density. This is very good because if you keep the area, the total area constant, you have the same power consumption overall, but you have much more stuff in it because you have reduced the dimension. So in the same area, you can put much more transistors and you have a much higher performance, both because of the fact that you have much more logic gates in the circuit and because of the fact that F, the clock frequency, is proportional to S. So can increase a lot. So basically, this is the best of all worlds. You have faster chips with much more logic in them, and the power consumption does not change. Okay. So, of course, what are you losing? You're losing the fact that supply voltage is not constant anymore. When you reduce the supply voltage, you do not have let's say compatibility with the old logic. You cannot change chip by chip. You need to redesign the complete system. You cannot just change the chip in a system because the supply voltage is different. Okay, this is very good for the problem of power consumption. You do not have the power crunch problem anymore. And so from 92, this thing started. From 92, we started to observe a decrease of the supply voltage in order to have constant field scaling. What happened is that from 1992 to 2002, we have this situation. So this is really history. This is what happened in the industry in those 10 years. The VDD went from 0.5, from 5 volt to, in 1992, to 1.5 volt of voltage supply, and the length was 0.5 micron in 1992 and became 0.13 micron in 2002. So this was the situation. I graduated in 1992. So basically, this is the situation when I graduated. And then in 10 years, we had a reduction. You see, more or less the same factor, the supply voltage and the gate length. So a factor which is a bit larger than 3, closer to 4, in 10 years. So almost an ideal constant field scaling. There is also an additional advantage of constant field scaling, and is the fact that you have less electric field stress. Because if you consider the thickness of the dielectric, the TOX, the oxide thickness, then it becomes thinner and thinner. And if you do not reduce the supply voltage, the electric field in the oxide is higher and higher. You reduce the oxide, but you do not reduce the supply voltage in the constant voltage scaling. You have higher and higher electric field. And this is very bad for reliability. You start to observe MOSFETs then break because the oxide basically, technically you say you have a breakdown of the oxide. The reliability becomes very poor. Instead, if you have constant field scaling, you reduce the thickness of the oxide, you also reduce the supply voltage, the field in the oxide becomes constant, and you do not have these reliability problems. So there's also a good an advantage from the point of view of reliability. So on the one hand, power consumption and reliability. Why this thing stopped? Because it seems really an ideal situation. And this is the situation that I remember it very clearly. At that time, every year there was a record in the clock frequency of processors, because it was something like 200 megahertz maybe in 1992, I do not remember exactly. And then the record in 2002 was an Intel processor of 3.2 gigahertz. This was the record. Okay? 3.2 gigahertz. If you notice it, it is higher than what we have now, and there is a reason for that. So year after year, there was a record in clock frequency, which meant a record in performance of the transistors. And of course, it meant that you need to have a more powerful fan over the processor. So because it was difficult to dissipate the energy. So in order to understand what happened exactly and why we had to change from constant field scaling in the last 10 years, I need to show you some plots. Let me just go here. Okay. So this is a figure that was presented by Patrick Gelsinger, who was a vice president of Intel in 2001, at a conference once every year in San Francisco. It's called ISSCC, International Solid State Circuit Conference. And basically showed this plot and with the statement that is highlighted above. Let me just illustrate a bit this thing. This is the power density. These are historical figures. The power density in Intel chips as a function of the production year. So we start from the 4004, the first microprocessor by Intel, the one that was designed by Federico Faggin and that discussed a bit at the beginning, was for a pocket calculator, if you remember. And then year by year, we have some changes. What is actually happening here? You see, at the beginning, okay, the power consumption is very small. Then you see this increase at the end of the 70s. Maybe I can make some notes. Okay, this is NMOS technology. Okay, this is NMOS technology. You have an increase in power consumption because you increase the frequency of operation and you reduce the dimensions. So of course you are at the constant voltage scaling here. Now, at this point, they start with CMOS. The 80286 was the first processor with the CMOS technology. And you see, the power consumption would increase up to here. It was too much. They decided to change the logic from NMOS to CMOS in order to push down power consumption. So this was intermediate with the 386, they were able to optimize. So here, this is the starting of CMOS. So first, second. Then they continue with constant voltage scaling, and therefore, of course, if you have constant voltage scaling, power goes up, because year after year you scale down. And this is what happens up to here. Okay? This was constant voltage scaling. Then here they go at constant, it's too long, constant field scaling. This is exactly what I told you. So they are able to decrease. Okay, they can scale down the voltage, the supply voltage, and therefore they can, let's say, not totally decrease the power density, but at least decrease with respect to what they would have if they did not decrease the power supply. So still it becomes manageable. And then at some point they realize here they cannot scale anymore the supply voltage. So this was basically the presentation. If we cannot scale anymore the supply voltage, then power density will increase in this direction, and this is the power density of a nuclear reactor, this is the power density of a rocket nozzle, and this is the power density of the sun surface. So basically this was a very pessimistic prediction, and by a VP of Intel at the time, the stock closed it was a Monday on February the 5th on 2001 at minus 2.8% because of this presentation, basically. Because the problem is, okay, the semiconductor industry is stalled. So there will be no continuous reduction in size, no continuous increase in performance because power consumption is too high. So again, NMOS, CMOS constant voltage scaling, CMOS constant field scaling. What happened here and why they could not reduce the power supply anymore? Let me just show you this. This is a problem. Because this is the power in a chip as a function of production year for several microprocessors of Intel. This active is PD, the dynamic power. The leakage is the static power. Typically, you do not consider the static power because most of the power consumption, almost the total power consumption is due to the dynamic component. And this is true, of course. But going close to 2000, you can see, you observe a strong increase in leakage current. And what they observed, okay, if we continue in this way, the static power will dominate over the dynamic power. And then it will continue to increase. So we cannot continue in this way. The problem with static power was precisely that the static power increased because of voltage scaling. Let me show you why. Let me show you why. Let me go back to this part. You remember I have drew transfer characteristics of a MOSFET in the semi-log scale. And the transfer characteristic goes like that. This is the threshold voltage. You have in this part the parabolic part, right? You are in saturation here, and in subthreshold actually we have an exponential behavior, which is a line, a straight line in the semi-log scale. In this region we have that I is proportional to VGS to exp to the exponential of VGS minus VTN or VTN over N VTH. This VTH is the thermal voltage. You remember I already wrote this expression in one of the first lecture. The IOF is this current, is the current that you have when VGS is equal to zero. So the off current, which is proportional to the static power dissipation, is exponentially dependent on the threshold voltage. The problem is that when you reduce the threshold voltage, you increase IOF. And it is clear, because if you reduce the threshold voltage here with voltage scaling, what you see is that IOF increases. You see the curve goes like that, and therefore the new IOF is this one. You have an increase of IOF. And the increase is exponential with VTN. Okay, this is the reason why on the previous plot you start to see this static power dissipation curve that is much steeper than the other one and goes up with scaling. It was this one, right? So, so this is scaling. So they decided that the voltage scaling was not good anymore and they had to stop. And this is basically 2002, the year at which they decided to change, let's say, strategy. And what happened basically? Let me just go again to my figure here. What they decided to do, if you look here, is to stop increasing the frequency of operation. Because if you do not increase the frequency of operation anymore, you can more easily keep the power density under control. So, starting from 2002, what we observe is that nobody increased the clock frequency anymore. Instead, they tried to decrease it in order to reduce the total power consumption. And then they started to, in order to improve performance, they started with parallelization. They started with using more cores in each processor. So the industry only took advantage of the reduction in size in order to put more cores on a single chip and did not exploit anymore the possible improvement in clock frequency. Okay? And it is exactly from 2002 that you have seen that chips are not faster anymore, but they only have more cores, so 2, 4, 8, and so on. And the reason was exactly this one. Yeah, I can write here the scaling without increasing clock frequency. So you have that the area is proportional to S, to 1 over S squared, of course, because it's W times L, but the power dissipation, the dynamic power dissipation, is just proportional to 1 over lambda, this is the reduction of VDD, times 1 over S, that is the reduction of C. Instead, you will have an increase in the voltage in the clock frequency, but you do not exploit it. When you make the ratio PD over A, you see that you have something like S over lambda squared. So if you want to keep this constant, you can just scale a bit the lambda, just to compensate for the numerator here. So the reduction in voltage, in supply voltage and in threshold voltage did not stop completely, but it could become slower and slower because there was a possibility to keep the power density more or less constant with scaling, with less effort. Okay. Okay, I need to make a correction to what I said before. I said the right thing, but I wrote the wrong formula. Because if we have PD over A, it was S squared over lambda squared. For lambda equal to 1, this becomes S squared, not 1 over S squared. Okay, so of course, since S is larger than 1, we have a problem of power crunch, because the power density increases. So simply we need to write here S squared. Okay. So just to corroborate the things that I said before, I wanted to show you some historical plots so that we can discuss them together. These are historical points. We have the production year and then some units that are different depending on the quantities that we plot. These red triangles are the supply voltage. Okay, so you see we start from a supply voltage here that is 5 volt, and then we have a decrease starting from 92, more or less, as I said. Then this this purple stars are the feature size, which more or less is the channel length, the minimum L. We start with 1.5 micron here in 86, and we go down to 0.13 here in 2002. This was 0.13 technology. And then you can see the significant decrease since on the y-axis we have a logarithm plot and the linear plot on the x-axis. This means that we have an exponential decrease of feature size. Okay, so from here, from the start of CMOS technology to 92, the voltage, the supply voltage, does not change, remains at 5 volts, and you have a decrease of channel length, okay, as I said before. From 92 to 2002, more or less, we have a decrease of the supply voltage from 5 to 1.5 volts, and you can see that it's almost identical to the decrease in feature size. So you decrease L and you decrease the voltage in the same way. So this is the constant field scaling. Okay. The blue diamonds here are the power consumption of the processor. And you can see they always increase for several reasons. Of course, when you have constant voltage scaling, this is what you expect. We have seen with constant voltage scaling, you keep the voltage constant, you put more transistor in the chip, you go faster, and of course you have a lot higher power consumption. This is normal. From 92 on, this should stop a bit, because we are now in the constant field scaling. But there are two different issues. On the one hand, there is an increase of the chip area, the total chip area. It's not really constant. It increases a bit by a factor of two or three in these 10 years. So there is something which is connected to the area increase of the total chip. But there is also another effect that I did not discuss previously, that is the improvement in chip architecture. Because of this improvement of chip architecture, we have a faster increase of the clock frequency with respect to the decrease of the propagation delay. So we have a decrease of the propagation delay, but the increase of clock frequency is not only justified by the decreased propagation delay. There are also improvements in the architecture that allow you to go faster. For example, the use of a smaller number of stages in the computational logic. And indeed, if we look at the ratio of the clock duration over the propagation delay, this T clock is the clock duration, which is the inverse of the clock frequency, and TP4 is, in this plot, the propagation delay of an inverter with fan out equal to 4. Okay, so of course we know that the clock period has to be larger than the propagation delay. Okay, but how much larger? In the 80s, it was 50 times larger, more or less. Now, because of the improvements in circuit architecture, it became something like 20 times larger, less than maybe 12 times larger. So this is not justified, because this is not justified by the reduction in propagation delay, because it is already normalized by the propagation delay. If the clock period was a constant factor of the propagation delay, here we would have a constant line, an horizontal line. Instead, there is an improvement in the architecture that has allowed to go to smaller T clock to propagation delay ratios. But of course, this has some problems because it increases the power consumption. Okay. So, what happens then? Here, these are again historical plot. I will give you this material, but it's important to understand what really happened in the industry in this time. This is again the same plot, but with the rest of the story. Again, this is the power consumption of microprocessors as a function of the production year for different families. Intel Alpha, which was a digital equipment processor, and many other. You have the increase that I have shown you up to 2002. Then what happens? You see, there's a stop. From 2003 to, in this case, 2009, but also now, we have a complete stop of the increase in power consumption. And the reason is that we had a stop in increase of clock frequency and improvement in parallelization. More cores that go a little bit slower. Now, the typical clock frequency of high-performance processors is less than 3 gigahertz. Okay. For mobile application, so the numbers are easy to remember, because 100 watts is the power consumption of a high-performance processor for desktop applications, for example. And for mobile applications, you go below 10 watts. Because, of course, then you have the additional problem of duration of battery charge. You see, with very few equations, we can understand what happened in the, in several years. Now, actually, in the last 10 years, there were also additional issues related to the difficulty in scaling down the devices. And I already discussed them, introduced them a bit in, during the first lecture, but now I want to go back and discuss things in a little bit more detail. This is the transistor of 2002, so 0.13 micron technology, 1.5 supply voltage. You see very clearly the gate, the channel. This technology was called 0.13 micron, but the active part of the channel was a little bit smaller, was just 70 nanometers, so half the technology node. So 0.13 was more or less from here to here. Okay, more or less. Then this is the source, this is the drain, this is the gate, and normal. Then there are there's the sequence of innovations, because this was possible because we did not increase the clock frequency anymore and because of some improvements in technology. Let's see them in detail. 2003, there was the introduction of strained silicon. So with strained silicon, this is a bad plot. The background should be blue, but I will change it. Again, on the right hand side, on the right hand side for you, it is the left hand side. You can see the N MOSFET, and we have a tensile strain. So there is this layer on top of the transistor that after typically it is deposited at high temperature. When the chip is cooled down, it has a different elastic constant, a different temperature coefficient of the elastic constant, and start to let's say apply a tensile stress on the silicon. This improves mobility of electrons. And on the other end, for PMOSFET, we have a complicated process in which we change the material of the source and of the drain with silicon germanium instead of silicon. This silicon germanium has a higher crystalline constant than silicon and starts to push. So we have a compressive strain applied to the channel. The compressive strain is good because it increases the mobility of holes. So in the end, we increase the mobility of electrons and of holes, and also increase the saturation velocity of electrons and of holes. What's the result? The result is that if you remember the formulas for the propagation delay, when we increase the saturation velocity, we are able to decrease the propagation delay if everything else becomes constant. Since we do not want to go faster, we can keep the same propagation delay by reducing the supply voltage. And therefore, we can reduce the total power consumption. So this was the main reason this process was introduced. We could keep the same propagation delay with reduced supply voltage. This was 2003. Of course, when you do this, you need to do the same thing for all the process in the following years. Otherwise, you lose this advantage and you have to find something else. Year after year, I have to improve things. So once you add some particular aspect of the process, then you have to keep it. Then there was the problem of leakage of the gate oxide. Because if you consider scaling, you remember you have to scale W, you have to scale L, but you also have to scale TOX. And in 2005, TOX was very, very small. In this plot on the left, in these photographs on the left, this is a TEM, transmission electron microscope photograph of a MOS, of the MOS stack, gate, oxide, and channel. The gate here was polysilicon, which is a crystalline, highly doped silicon that, that basically behaves as a metal. Then there's a thin layer of silicon oxide, the dielectric, and the layer is 1.2 nanometers. So it's just four atoms. The white parts are the single atoms. With transmission electron microscope, you can see atom per atom. So basically, you have a layer of oxide which is just four atoms. So it's very difficult to fabricate, extremely difficult to control, because if you lose these four atoms at some point, you have a short circuit between the gate and the channel. Therefore, the device does not work. So the process was incredible. But also, in addition to that, there was the problem that electrons could tunnel through the oxide that was so thin, and you started to have a significant gate current, which you do not want, because the gate current is a leakage current. It's something that is there also when the transistor is switched off, and therefore adds to the static power consumption. So in 2005, things changed completely, and instead of using silicon oxide, the industry with Intel, that was the first to introduce the process, started to use a high K dielectric. A high K means high dielectric constant. Is a dielectric with a very high dielectric constant. The dielectric constant of silicon oxide is 3.9, is an absolute number. The dielectric of the high K material is something closer to, the average dielectric constant is closer to 12. Okay? Which means that if you want to keep the Cox, E epsilon ox over Tox constant, you can promptly increase Tox a lot. So since the dielectric constant is increased a lot, you can increase the thickness of the oxide and basically is as if you had decreased the thickness of the silicon oxide. So the whole industry started to do that. In order to do that, you need to change the type of material for the gate, and therefore was not more polysilicon anymore, but they started to use special metals for the gate. So lots of changes that were introduced in 2005, and then you need to keep from then until the end of the technology, let's say, for many, many years to come. You need to consider that the main reason why silicon was used as a semiconductor for electronics was because it was easy to grow on silicon a good oxide that was silicon oxide. But then at some point, we basically removed completely the silicon oxide and we substituted with some special high K dielectric. Of course, silicon was kept because there's so much investment in the technology, and the technology is so good now that, I mean, it would be crazy to change from silicon to something else unless there were incredible advantages. Then, in 2011, the three gate transistor technology. You can see, last time I discussed it with my hands, basically you have a fin instead of a transistor, instead of the channel, and then the gate is around. And the main reason to do that is that, if you do not do that, you start to lose the electrostatic control of the transistor, and therefore you have a strong degradation in performance. So in order to keep scaling, you have to change the geometry. This is just to stress the fact that it's not just the scaling of length and of voltages. There's also a complete revolution in the types of material and device geometries used for keeping the pace of scaling of CMOS technology in the last 10 years. Okay.